Good afternoon. Thanks for coming to our presentation about using Tableau to inform 21st century fundraising. With your good friends from the Cornell University Alumni Affairs and Development Consulting Team, I'm Bruce Higgins, joined by Kevin Coates and Carl Sedlacek. We just want to real quickly respect your time and make sure we get the right people in the room. You are most likely to benefit from this presentation if you are in a nonprofit, particularly if you do fundraising or fundraising support. Maybe you're talking about a smaller organization, hundreds of people, not thousands, budget constrained like most of us are. Maybe your management isn't cutting edge, particularly with respect to IT. And you're having sort of the traditional growing pains with data delivery. But you have a scheme, you have a glint in your eye, you're a data entrepreneur. You have ambitions, and you think Tableau can help you get to where you want to be. We're going to talk a bit about building a data science team, about how you establish trust and credibility in your organization. We're going to look at some fundraising data, answer some fundraising questions, and this will, of course, be happening with the help of Tableau software, which we love and adore. The obligatory slide about who we are, Cornell University. We are pretty much in the middle of New York State. This is what it looks like on a good day. Give you a sense of the scale. We are the largest employer in New York outside of New York City. We've got, 10,000 employees, 11,000, 21,000 students, hundreds of thousands of records, millions of gift records. We do about $500 million a year in gift activity. That's, dollars that people just hand over to us. Our environment is PeopleSoft, which is an Oracle product. We run on Oracle databases. We use Hyperion, Brio, and Tableau for our reporting. So we're going to try and explain 2 years' worth of work to you in 45 minutes. And it's going to happen in a fairly orderly procession as if we planned it all out. The reality was messy, so we've sort of gone back retroactively and organized things into a talk that we could deliver to an audience such as yourselves. And what we've done is we sort of come across the notion of the spiral of trust, and we've sort of walked our audience with us, and we think about it as if you're at the Guggenheim Museum in New York, and you walk up that spiral ramp. And on the one hand, you're kind of going around in circles, but on the other hand, every time you go around, you're at a higher level. And that's kind of what we're trying to do with this, is to move people up to a higher level. If we were in the Guggenheim, we might put labels on the museum that looked like this. When you walk in, you're on the lobby, level one. You're going to build your team, you're going to set some goals, you're going to figure out who you are, and you're going to go along, you're going to show people that you know what you're doing, and more than just showing that you know what you're doing, you're going to actually add value to the discussion, to the point that people actually start coming to you with questions, looking for answers rather than data requests. And ultimately, you want to be in a position where you're actually leading the way, where you're breaking new ground. And to do all this, we talk about using Tableau as our evolution engine. We're using Tableau to help evolve ourselves and evolve our audience along the way. And an important component to all of this is going to be teaching people, educating your audience as you go along. Okay, step one. This is the toughest part to talk about because everybody comes to it from a different place. Every organization has politics and history and personalities, and you're not going to be able, not everybody's going to have the luxury of establishing a team from the ground up as we actually were able to. But the point is this: is to wherever you are in your evolution as a team, to sort of stand up and recognize yourself as a group and say, "Hey, we are us, and we are going to do something. We're going to make a difference." As I said, we had the good fortune to be born of a kind of a big bang where it became decided that we needed a business intelligence group. And we actually went out and grabbed people from different parts of the organization and, in fact, from the university. Carl over here came from the central IT shop. We brought in a researcher, statistician from our research shop. Kevin here was in the business and accounting end of things, and I was in sort of the internal IT reporting department. So we were actually able to say, look, we're going to take, you know, four or five people, now actually six, put them in a room and say, you guys are going to do this stuff. You're going to do BI. And so the important thing was to, you know, so that was our story. We were able to build ourselves. Some of you are not going to, you know, most of you are not going to have the luxury to start from there, but you always have the ability to sort of recognize and establish your own identity. And that was pretty important to us to actually just make that decision. Once we formed ourselves, you know, we didn't want to just sort of send out the usual email that said, hey, we have this new department, we're called Consulting Services. We said, let's show them what we can do. Had a little fun with it. And rather than using Tableau to tell the story of some data, we actually built the data to tell the story that we wanted to tell. So we have a little graphical staff directory. And we've got little charts with pull-down menus where if you have a question about a piece of subject matter or a piece of software, you can go to the chart, and it'll actually pop up and tell you which one of us is your best bet. Just a fun little thing that we did to sort of establish ourselves. So the next thing, you need to set goals. And this is above and beyond your normal organization annual goal setting objectives, okay, where you're talking about what's going to happen for the organization, for the company, for the university. What do you want for yourselves? And you get to decide this. What we wanted, or what has emerged as what we wanted, as we look back on it, I think first and foremost, we want a seat at the table. We want to be up there with the decision makers when decisions are happening. We want our input solicited and valued. We think that people could be asking better questions. And by providing better answers and asking questions in public, we're trying to sort of raise the level of people's inquisitiveness in the organization. We want to do cool stuff. We want to become data scientists, and this is sort of a key objective for us as individuals trying to make our way in the world. You read a lot about data scientists being, you know, highly prized and hard to find, and data scientists have PhDs in economics and astrophysics and statistics, and apparently these people are hard to find. Can't imagine why. We think a couple of things. You know, if you read about the data science industry, one of the things which comes to the forefront is that the secret sauce to all of this is business understanding and knowledge of the data. And we have that. We know our business better than anybody, certainly anybody in the university, and we like where we stand relative to the industry. And the other stuff, you know, statistical stuff, we can figure that stuff out. We hired a statistician. And as we look at, as we plan out our careers and our career development options and the conferences we come to, such as this one, you know, in 5 years' time, we actually want to be real data scientists. We're not there yet, but that's our goal. And we think that's a very good thing for us. Selfishness aside, we also want to provide business intelligence at the speed of thought. I believe that's an old Bill Gates notion. You know, this business of asking a question and waiting a week for the IT shop to grind things through the mainframe are in the past. We want to be able to do things on the fly, and you've certainly seen a lot of that already this week. We are, in the long run, looking to achieve enterprise sentience, wherein the left arm in the organization knows what the right arm is doing at all times, and all the information is readily available to everyone. And then along the way, we actually want to, you know, pitch in and help out with the raising of the $4.75 billion. How are we going to go about doing this? Tactically, you know, as we've seen already, there's a big piece here about establishing credibility and confidence. You have to make yourself known as believable individuals, that you know what you're doing. Additionally, what we had to do with Tableau was sell confidence in Tableau, because our audience didn't understand that it was just another SQL tool that queries databases. It was a whole new thing, and they didn't believe in it. They didn't believe that they could get the same answers out of Tableau as they got out of the tools they were used to using. Having done that, we're then going to start to build Tableau presentations into our meetings and use them to actually persuade people, to change people's minds about things, to the point where we create new norms. And along the way, we've made it a point of being awesome. And we kid about it a lot, but we take it very seriously. You know, we ask ourselves, you know, most every staff meeting, we say, what did you do that was awesome this week? Because it's fun being awesome. And it's fun being funny about being awesome. And speaking of awesome, I want to let my friend and colleague Kevin Coates tell you a little bit about building confidence.
Well, thank you, Bruce. what I want to talk about is the establishing credibility portion. And we thought the best way to lead into that conversation is to talk about how we started and failed. A lot of times in presentations, you hear about the success of whatever that individual presenting, their successes, but you never hear about how many times they failed. And, you know, this is really a nonlinear thing when we talk about the spiral of trust, and a lot of failure happens along the way. So an example that we have here is one of the first dashboards we put together to answer a question. Rather than using the typical spreadsheet or pivot table, we put together a beautiful visualization and delivered it to management. And we did a couple similar type presentations. And each time it failed, and it was really epic failure. The reason being is we were just so excited about using Tableau, and you could go online and look at all the beautiful visualizations, and you could see that you could tell your story about data in a new way that brought color to the world. And it fails because your audience, your customers, aren't there with you yet. So if you look at the top right-hand corner, we have the image of thinking outside the box, and that's exactly where we started. We were trying to be awesome, but we were trying to be awesome a little too soon. So we had to temper that expectation. And an example of why is because this is where we were. This is an example of a report that we produce on a weekly basis for senior leadership team and program directors. This is where their comfort level was. If you look at the top right-hand corner, they're in the box. Not only are they in the box, they're in the center directly, just sitting there in the middle of that box. So for us to immediately start off with a visualization that was completely outside the box really was shame on us, and we didn't understand our customers. So by taking a step back and looking at revisiting where we went wrong, we were able to come to this conclusion that we don't want to think outside the box, but we want to think inside the box, but on the edge. And an example of how we thought about that is we just recreated visualizations, or not even visualizations, but pivot tables in the spreadsheet that we were already delivering on a weekly basis in Tableau. You can see here, it's really a pivot table with two bar charts. But what we pushed in the meetings was the ability to interact with the data real time. You can see that we set up filters so that each person could become somewhat of their own analyst. They can look at their college and unit. They can look at year-over-year type data to do apples-to-apples comparisons. You can also dive into each one of these numbers. We're using SQL to query this data. So this information was live. It was fresh every day that they would open up this view. And we sold them there. And by selling them there, by meeting them at their level, we started to get buy-in. And we started to establish that level two of we reestablished our expertise and reestablished our credibility with a new tool by meeting them at their level and making sure they were comfortable with it before we moved on. The other thing we did that went along with level two is every time we released a Tableau report, we would release trainings to go along with it. So we'd have the initial rollout, but right with that initial rollout, we would do the functional trainings by unit. We would do brown bag lunches where we would meet in an office at, you know, noon, and everyone could just show up on their own accord. We do one-on-one 15-minute type trainings, and we did video trainings. We purchased Camtasia, and we have a person that we call Silky Smooth that is very good at delivering these presentations, has a nice voice for it. And an example, a snapshot of that is to the right there where we released an Ask Status report that actually has a training tutorial with it. These are short, under 3-minute type videos. We found that that was the most effective way to get people to listen to it for the whole duration. And we met them at their level, so we made it easy for them. We reduced friction so that they can go out and do training in their own time. We have a lot of people who travel around here. We have over 85 giving officers, so they're on the road a lot. And so for them to be able to go in and use Tableau on their iPad and actually, you know, do a quick training tutorial before they get into a report on how to use it on their iPad was a very effective way to push out and deliver these reports. So if we start looking at the thinking outside the box analogy, we can take it to the edge of normal, which is your left-hand side here. That was the original Tableau report that we created. So we're still inside the box. We're inside everyone's comfort zone, but we're introducing them to a new tool. They became more comfortable. We trained them. And the innovation doesn't move. The thought doesn't move. The whole box moves. So by doing this, you're actually establishing a new norm within the organization. You know, we talked about the enterprise sentience. Well, there it is. And after you get to this point, then you can move back out onto the edge of the box, you can see you're back thinking outside your original box. So you've accomplished your goal without ever forcing your customers to leave their comfort zone. We found this to be a very effective approach. Here's an example of us taking it back to the edge of the box. This happened because, you know, as we established this level two trust and credibility, we started to get invited to meetings. And the question in a certain meeting that we were in was the VP hammering on the table wondering if we had enough money in the work plan to reach our fiscal year goal. And dialogue went back and forth over and over, and solution or a strategy or solution was never a result of those conversations. It just went on and on. We went back to the drawing board and said, okay, let's use Tableau to create what we call a what-if analysis. If you look over here, we created these sliders that show the percent of work plan that goes complete and the percent yield that goes complete. Well, we know on a regular basis that about 60% of the work plan goes complete in a fiscal year. We also know that about 30% of that 60% goes complete in real time and real cash totals. So if you start playing with these numbers, you'll see this gift or the work plan ask high amount drop significantly. And if you remove things like the big asks, which are unlikely to happen in a given fiscal year, you'll notice that you actually drop well below that fiscal year goal. And this gives management a better understanding of how to approach the fiscal year, how many gifts they need on the bench in case something's not going to happen. It also allows the individual work groups to do their own analysis and the collagen units. So with that, I'm going to reintroduce Bruce Higgins on persuading a skeptical audience.
So, you've got something out of the ordinary, something that people haven't seen before. You want to convince them to use it. We've been trying to introduce predictive analytics into our organization. It's a pretty hot topic in fundraising, and we hadn't met with much success. And this largely was due to our our main statistician was down in the research office, and she wasn't getting the traction that she needed. So we embarked on a relaunch of the whole notion of predictive analytics with our annual fund. And they gave us the question of the people who made a gift last year, who are more and less likely to make a gift this year? Okay, because they're really worried about their retention, and they want to be able to keep people giving, because the people who do give year after year seem to continue giving year after year. So we did a whole bunch of predictive analytics voodoo. We did the normalization and the significance testing and all of that. Came up with a bunch of scores, okay? So if I'm a donor, over the last 5 years, how many years am I likely to have given? You know, 1 to 5. So we did all that. We came up with scores. We scored their population. And the question was, how do you get our annual fund people who are very data-driven and very black and white, number-driven type people to sort of accept this probabilistic exercise? And how do you make them believe that it actually has relevance to them? And then how do you figure out what to do with it? So the first thing we did to show them, to illustrate the meaningfulness of the scores, was to map them against their market segmentations. So they have 150 different segmentations that they target for their solicitations throughout the year. And so we had 100,000 scores, and what I wanted to do was show them in one simple image that all of the scores married their population in the groups that you would expect them to map. So here, the dark rectangles are your best donors, and the light rectangles are your worst donors. And when you look at it, you can very quickly see that the darkest ones are the ones you would expect. The little red one there towards the top right is the trustee box. Those are our largest and most loyal donors. The non-donors are quite white, and all the intermediate shades are what you would expect them to be. So this is a nice tree map that does a good job of showing how a large set of numbers maps to a large population in a way that actually makes sense. This is our JEDI visualization. We spent about a week and a half of supercomputer time to generate this incredibly sophisticated graph. What it does, I mean, the point here is simplicity sells. And what this chart says is the people we said are going to give 1 year, give 1 year. People said we give five, give five. So we map the scores against their actual behavior. It maps very closely in aggregate. Having done that, so the sort of question was, well, gee, that's great. You successfully predicted the past. Can you predict the future? And as it happened, we could, because we had conducted this exercise most of the way through our last fiscal year. So we took the numbers that we had generated from the previous 5 years and ran them against the current year's giving. And lo and behold, the people that we said would give were more likely to give. The people we said were less likely to give were less likely to give. Pretty compelling argument that we've got a bunch of numbers here which are useful and predictive. What do you do with that? Okay. This is the action slide. This is where you can see, you know, how do I take action on this information that you have so generously given me, Bruce? Well, look, in aggregate, we saw that the giving map to the scores, but if you actually break it down individually, you see that not everybody behaves the same. In the top left, you've got people who scored high but have given a low number of years. And on the bottom right, you see the people who scored low but have given a high number of years. So the green people are overperformers and the red people are underperformers. And the folks in the middle are the ones that the model pretty much predicts what they're going to do and thus isn't terribly helpful for us. What this enables the annual fund to do is think about their messaging. So for their 150 market segmentations, they now have 300 or 450, depending on how you want to think about it. Because within each segment, you're going to have underperformers and overperformers, and you're going to want to send a different message to them. And real-life outcome is they're still struggling with that. They're going to do something with it, but they haven't figured out what the messaging is going to be. And now, having successfully persuaded a skeptical audience, we are really gaining momentum. Here's Kevin Coates.
So if we're looking at that spiral of trust slide, we're about on level four now, because we're going to talk about being solicited for better questions. One of the things that we started to notice as we went through this progression is people started to show up at our doorstep and were asking much different questions than what they had asked in the past. Instead of asking for list type questions, we were getting more open-ended questions, open dialogue, and having conversations about really interesting strategies that are on the minds of the program directors and senior leadership team. So a couple of examples we wanted to show to you all today. The first one is, the type of question we would receive in the past is, I need a list of gifts to a scholarship campaign. And this is typical, a list, how much, how many. And we would give them a report that looks something like this. We have a pivot table here with donor, gift type, gift date, and then the financial information behind that challenge. Not much to be had here, not much insight to be had. And the question started to progress from something like this, where the feedback, if we got any, was, could you do it again? You know, or could you update it through the current date? To feedback that sometimes we would never even hear back from the person once we delivered a report. So we don't know how effective our reporting was. But now we're getting questions like this. How has the scholarship campaign impacted donor behavior? And we came to a solution much like this, and we presented it to the individual who asked the question. Same type of scholarship challenge report. We're looking at 212 distinct donors. We broke it down in a couple different ways. So if you look at the left-hand side of your screen right here, has 10-year giving changed? We normalized the axis so that the zero would be the scholarship launch. So if you're minus 10, you're a donor who had been giving 10 years before the launch of the scholarship challenge. So if you look at this, you can see that the average gift amount, actually after the scholarship challenge launch, has started to decline. 2 years after, it's declined to a low, all-time low for this group, or at least a 10-year low for this group. So has it changed giving, the scholarship challenge? Well, yeah, it has, actually, in a negative way. So that's not good. We also looked at the re-engagement of donors from this scholarship pool, from this 212 distinct donors. Again, a normalized axis. So if you were minus 17, you hadn't given a gift before your first scholarship gift in 17 years. Likewise, in minus 12, minus 11, you haven't given a gift in 11 or 12 years. So the reason this was important is because did it re-engage donors? Well, yeah, if you sum up all these people, it's a pretty substantial population within this 212 group. So was it successful as a re-engagement tool? Yes. But again, if you look at donations over time since 1980 from this pool, you can see that the median gift amount 2 years out is as low as it was in 1990. So the questions we can come back with and have a conversation with the program director on the scholarship challenge is, you know, what's the follow-up look like? You know, was there any follow-up with the scholarship challenge? Because it looks like giving has gone down since the challenge. Another question that we would have been asked in the past was, how many alumni do we have that have children who went to Cornell? And this is a type of report that we would have delivered for that. We would have had dollar totals over time, and we would have done gift amount over time, breaking down alumni giving based on the red being a representation of alumni who are also Cornell parents, and then the light pink alumni non-Cornell parent. Doesn't mean they're not a parent, it just means their child's not going to Cornell. And this is the type of information we would have provided, again, updated it over time, and never got any sort of feedback or had any dialogue with the program director. The most recent question we got in regards to this alumni parent exercise was, how do we create a sustainable parents program when we only have a 4-year window with parents? We were able to take that question and create a bunch of slides within a Tableau workbook, but the most interesting one happened to be this, a single stacked bar chart with a moving average, 4-year giving moving average line. And we just color-coded, again, the alumni non-Cornell parent and the alumni Cornell parent. The axis is their giving over their lifetime. And you can see what happens is, if you follow the alumni Cornell parent, you can see after they graduate, their giving is much less than that of the alumni who's a non-Cornell parent. But then this intersection happens right here, and it just so happens that's about the same time their first child enrolls at Cornell. And you see a huge spike in their giving at that time. Well, this kind of surprised us because we weren't expecting to see a person who's paying $60,000+ to send their child to Cornell to all of a sudden become these huge givers. Well, in hindsight, it makes sense because these are the people who not only went to Cornell, now they're sending their child to Cornell. They love Cornell. I mean, they love Cornell, and they probably have the money to give. This is something that seems obvious now, but we hadn't recognized them before that way. We never thanked them saying, hey, thanks a lot for being an alum and a Cornell parent. We really appreciate that. We just said, thank you for being an alum. The parents program picked up on this, and with this, looking at this gap, they said, okay, we need to start engaging these people because as big as this giving, big as this gap is, it could be even wider because we've never recognized them before. So what more can we do with them to engage them? The other thing they wanted to look at is how to create engagement opportunities with the Cornell alumni who's a non-Cornell parent. How do you engage them in similar ways that these people are engaged with their child's enrollment? Now, it's probably not possible, but what other engagement opportunities can lead to a little bit better giving here? So those are the types of things and conversations that took place after we shared this slide with the VP of Development. So when we have those types of conversations with the decision makers, we become partners with them. And a most recent question we received was, how do we change the culture of giving? And we realized we're not even answering questions. We're just helping to create some insight to better inform strategy for the fiscal year or for the organization as a whole. This is a quick slide, a small dashboard on what we created when we started looking at ask high amounts of, you know, how do we change the culture of giving? Well, how much are we asking for? What does giving look like over time? And you can see in 2008, 2007, there was a fairly large ask high amount. And then it drops off in 2009, and it continues a downward trend until you see 2012, it picks back up. But the point is, even 2012 is much less than 2008 and 2007. And one of the things we quickly realized is we changed the endowment level. And we changed it as we raised the endowment level to $250,000 right in July of 2009, so starting the fiscal year of 2009. And you could see a huge drop in the ask high amount. Well, you know, this raises lots of questions of, you know, why that happens. Is this a low-hanging fruit type idea, or what type of are giving officers are trying to hit their goals? But those aren't questions for us to answer, but it's certainly something to help inform their managers on how they want to talk about performance dialogues and see if there's better ways to ask for gifts at a higher level. Are we asking for enough money? With that, we get into the data scientist sphere. And this is where we want to talk about leading the way, that level five type stuff. So I'll introduce Carl to talk to you about that.
So this is just another aspect of the data scientist portion Bruce mentioned. I think everything that we do is a component of data science in terms of understanding the business, being able to manage increasingly larger and more diverse types of data, the statistical component, and then the ability to understand how to deliver the information in a meaningful way, and in our case, using Tableau. So some of the challenges of big data and particularly social media that all organizations are having to look at is just the size and the complexity of the data and whether or not it's business relevant to people and how best to deliver it. So some of the aspects of this is are people evaluating tool sets to look at multiple data sources. So in this case, what this really means is we have a concept here of value-added data, which is the data that is not in our institutional record-keeping systems. So it's data that we harvest from new data sources that we're starting to develop, and they're not really necessarily big data. They're alternative data sources that have what we think are leverageable and high-value data content in them. So as we start to analyze new data sources such as social media, we're looking to find the business relevance in there, and once we understand that, we have to manage that data, capture it, refine it, put it into a usable format, place it somewhere where we can use it in conjunction with our institutional data, our structured data, and then figure out how best to deliver it into the pipeline of research, whether we visualize it and at some point have a set of products and tools that allow our researchers and our prospect managers and our senior level management people to understand how it impacts the business and to bring it to a level of maturity like the information that Bruce and Kevin just described that allow us to not only get better questions but also have an impact on how the business is structured, because we have goals that we want to do here in our organization, and obviously of increasing our revenue and so forth, and so we have to, this is another way of moving the box, moving ourselves to the edge of the box, figuring out what that new norm is, and then sort of making it more robust and part of the process. So, tools to query unstructured data, there's a number of vendors out there. Do you, go ahead and subscribe to something like Tumblr or Meltwater, or do you build your own? Especially if you're dealing with high volumes of data and you want to manipulate it yourself, then you have to, potentially build your own tools to capture this data and manage it. LinkedIn, is a very popular thing. Twitter, these are all popular. How do you, is it a one-way dialogue? Do you control the scope of these social media sites? Do you seed them with information? How do you do this so that you can develop enough volume of information that is relevant to you, to Cornell or to the business, that you can actually understand and measure, the effect of your business decisions and so forth? Web crawling or scraping tools. There's a lot of information out there that's really laborious to get. There are firms such as Forbes and others who put an awful lot of money into researching their information, but it's not easy to get. You can't always buy it. Sometimes you have to go out and figure out how to get it down for yourself without doing it all manually. And obviously, there are policies around all of this data, and there are the compliance issues that are legal, and then there are internal policies that institutions like Cornell that developed it go over and above this. So these are issues that people have to struggle with. And so we wanted to go ahead and make some inroads into some of these areas, and one of them that we did was, well, how do we deal with Twitter, for example? Our social media group has been using, you know, some vendor products that sort of deliver information in real time, but if you're not there to look at it and capture it, it's ephemeral. It's even more ephemeral than Twitter itself. So we decided a test bed for us would be to go ahead and see if we could predict the Pope. And the question is, why would you do this? Because it doesn't really have a lot to do with fundraising. On the other hand, it is a time-constrained, time-boxed, event. It has an awful lot of information that's rich in content and opinion. It happens quickly, and it's high volume. And so, for example, we captured, 78,000 plus tweets in about 20 days, and several, over a million rows of data that was process for some initial visualization. Tools that we use were Python Python and Perl because they are readily available. They are our libraries that allow us to connect to Twitter and do manipulation of the data and so forth. So we grabbed the data with Python and we processed the data with Perl, cleaned it up and outputted it to a delimited file. And then we created a simple visualization, and if you look over to the right, you can see that we have a date filter, and we have a token filter, which is either a hashtag, a median mention, a URL, or a word. And down below, you can see we had a whole list of queries. And so what we used this for was we combined, we used it to try to get a notion of sentiment, to do sentiment analysis about the various cardinals. So you can't predict the Pope based on just sentiment out there in Twitter. I mean, you could give it a whirl, and you'd come up with some really interesting results, many of which were pretty darn close. But it was we combined this with what we would do normally internally in terms of developing a scoring database. So since we didn't have Glear or some of these other companies that would tell us about the cardinals, we went out and did our own research on the social sites of especially like Wikipedia, and we went over to the Vatican sites and so forth, and the biographies that were delivered had consistent content in them, and so because of that, we decided that they had these indicators of information, whether somebody was had been previously considered, papabile, or whether they were an internationalist, whether they had diplomatic experience, whether or not they were very, high up in the Vatican structure or part of the different congregations. All these kinds of dimensions where we kind of developed a scoring about them. And then we use this as a way of seeing what the social sentiment was about any of these individuals. Now, remember, when you do a search, you're looking at them as a hashtag, or you're looking at them as to what they tweet themselves, and so forth. And so it's very interesting. You can develop a pretty good idea of what the social feeling is when you look at the content of the words, some of the trigger words, like abuse and things like that were very, very powerful. And you could look at their segmentation around the world. And we did definitely had, the Europeans, and we had the internationalists and the Americans. And it was a very interesting interplay. So Pope Francis Bergoglio, Cardinal Bergoglio, became Pope, and we got tired on Monday morning when we were capturing tweets, so we turned off the Twittering machine, unfortunately, and there were a couple of low-frequency, high-value tweets around 10 o'clock on Monday morning that talked about Bergoglio saying, if you don't have a Pope by 1 p.m., then look to Bergoglio, and in fact, we didn't have a Pope at 1 p.m., but we certainly had Bergoglio around 5 or 6 p.m. So this was a lot of fun, and we learned a lot, and it was a great source of data for this kind of an exercise. So we turned to Reunion, and we looked at Reunion and Cornell itself, the hashtags. And so we this is just a simple word cloud of URLs. And so the question is, what is this URL that is so popular during this period of time, this week of time in the late spring, and it's a URL about one of our nationally recognized lacrosse players, and that was the hot topic. Now, if you take out reunion, Cornell out of the mix and just look at the reunion hashtag, then you see some things that are more reunion related and certainly appear to be very positive. Breakfast on the hill and loving the tours. You could come up with any number of combinations here, but the main thing is that basically looking at processing the data is a first step at understanding how Twitter can or any of these social media sites can work with us. We mentioned LinkedIn. We have a LinkedIn group, and so therefore we have access to people who are actually opting into our LinkedIn group, and there's profile information there, so that's something to be explored. So some next steps with regard to, you know, Twitter and LinkedIn, but here specifically Twitter, we did some simple phrase clouds, and we can look for that for sentiment and topic mining, especially if we can scope it around particular events and so forth that we advertise hashtags for. Collecting additional profile information about people, you actually need to be able to ascribe, these tweets and so forth to our people here at Cornell. I mean, is this a Cornelian who's actually saying these things? So we need to, we're actively trying to capture Twitter handles and so forth for people as part of our internal processes. Developing friends. Obviously, we can do some more sophisticated things in terms of trying to do automatic sentiment analysis, and so using things like WordNet or ConceptNet or SemanticNet, which are evolving databases out there to help us do non-manual sentiment analysis really could be helpful. Obviously, we need to reapply this to real-world examples, and scalability is going to be an issue if we really go after this stuff and build out networks of, Twitter handles and friends and so forth, and be able to process this information. And then, of course, bringing this back to Tableau, we have to figure out how to best deliver this information to our customers, and that would be typically with Tableau in the end.
So, all of the stuff you just saw that Carl just talked about, that was us leading the way. Nobody said to us, go out and predict the Pope. Nobody said to us, your job is to monitor the reunion tweets. Okay, this is stuff that we empowered ourselves to do, and that we have the latitude to and the trust to be allowed to sort of go off on our own and do these things. So it's a really exciting time for us. And we sort of end here with our enterprise sentient slide, because this is where we're going. You know, we want to be data scientists. We want to get paid like data scientists. And we want to be part of this great big globe of fish spinning around in the ocean, knowing that we are spinning fish in the ocean, and that the fish on the far left knows what the fish on the far right is going to do. Do I have a mousey thing? Here are some resources. These are some of the things that we have looked at in the past and would recommend that you might look at. Stephen Field, Edward Tufte, if you don't know by now, more or less have written the books on data visualization, information display. There's a conference out in Seattle called Drive, which we haven't been to yet, but plan to next year. It's data reporting, information visualization, enterprise or something. Exchange. The APRA group, if you're into fundraising, APRA is the Association of Professional Research Advancement. I don't know, it's advancement research stuff. And they're really heavy into fundraising analytics as well as prospect research. It's a good conference for that sort of thing. The TTWI, if you do anything on the internet with computers, you probably wind up getting spammed by TTWI. Good information to be gotten there. It is expensive. We don't get to go there terribly often. Building data science teams, DJ Patel, who worked, I believe it was for LinkedIn, Wrote a really nice paper about building, you know, building the data science team there and what it was like to sort of discover data science and big data from the ground up. Back on the fundraising tip, Josh Burkholz wrote a book called Fundraising Analytics, which really gives you a nice soup to nuts look at modern fundraising operation and how you might go about measuring it. And again, by now, you know, if you didn't see Nate Silver the other day, well, you should read Nate's book if you haven't. Of course, you all of you probably already have. And that brings us to the end of the presentation. We have ascended to the top of the Guggenheim and are looking down at where we were 2 years ago. Do you have questions for us? Thanks so much for playing our game. And we're done.